It's a significant day since we have been doing all our programs in Sinhala. Today we are embarking on another project which we should say taking Dhamma in the English stream. And so we have got Asaji Swaminasa, a former attorney at law, who was in my profession but who has left and got into robes. And Asaji Swaminasa had been studying the Dhamma fairly closely, and then he had been preaching in India with Loka Swaminasa and had made a lot of observations about the Dhamma and how it should be inculcated among our devotees, and to take the Dhamma, the message itself. I think he had done yeoman service in India in the last 6 to 7 months, and he had been preaching in English, and in order to facilitate as to the Dhamma, how it should be brought upon and to have a bearing on the foreign devotees. Because the Tripitaka, which we have been talking of, and we have been talking about the Dhamma, the Sutra Pitaka, Vinaya Pitaka, the Abhidhamma Pitaka, which all have been done in Sinhala in the recent past in our programs with the assistance, and I think Jnana Vijaya Swaminasa, we are indebted to him because the gratitude we should have towards him, he will be there because this program will be alternated along with the Sinhala programs together with the English program. Every other week there will be Jnana Vijaya Swaminasa also will be with us. And there we had gone a long way with Samatha Vidarshana and to the realms of perception, no perception, and so on and so forth. But today, of course, what we are trying to do is we are trying to go with the basics of the Dhamma in order to find what the Dhamma is, how we should set your mind on the Dhamma, and through which we could encourage ourselves. That is, encouragement comes through effort, faith, which we have been talking about, and about the fortitudinous of mind. And when we take the five strengths to so-called, that is about the mindfulness, the effort, faith, and the subjects that come along with that, in order for us to get on to the marga, the Arya Ashtanga marga, and from there on, that's the Noble Eightfold Path. And how this today, why I confine myself only to three aspects of the five strengths, is the fact that faith is something which a lot of people are today discussing. They have doubts about it as to whether one should have faith, and how, what type of faith is this? Is this blind faith, or is this faith with some sort of a basis, or how one should get into the Dhamma when you are trying to understand the subject as to why faith is so necessary, and it has become necessary in order to furtherance, in order to furtherance your the knowledge in Dhamma. So we will need faith, we will discuss about faith, we will talk about effort and about mindfulness, and samadhi, and other topics which we will be dealing in the coming programs. So let me get back to the basics and then start off with the elucidation as to what faith is. And to assist us and to take us through these programs in the English language is Asaji Swaminasa. And first and foremost, we will welcome Reverend Asaji for today's program. And indeed, this is going to be another benchmark where we are having this English program. And so through this, our effort is to propagate the Dhamma, and it will be a reality and it will be a success, no doubt. So today, let me start off the program after welcoming Reverend Swaminasa. My first question to Swaminasa would be, Swaminasa, about faith, as to what faith is all about. If you could define what faith is, or give us some sort of illustration as to why faith is required and why we should have this faith in order to understand the Dhamma.
Namo Buddhaya. Namo Buddhaya,
Swaminasa.
Actually, when we talk about Buddhism, before 2000 years ago, 2600 years ago, a great person appeared in this world. Everybody knows that he is the Lord Buddha. Lord Buddhas are appearing in this world with one idea. That is the one and only idea of coming and of appearing in this, into this world. That is to bring happiness. But it is not a simple happiness. It is the supreme happiness, supreme liberation from the suffering. So, to go to that supreme liberation, where there is no suffering, we need to have the faith on Lord Buddha and the teachings of the Lord Buddha, and also the great followers, the disciples of the Lord Buddha. Lord Buddha said, the base is the faith, we say confidence. Without that, we can't go beyond. Lord Buddha said, Saddha Abhijam. Faith is the seed. To have this, to have this supreme liberation. So, if somebody wants to have the supreme liberation from all these sufferings, suffering means it's a noble truth which is taught by the Lord Buddha. Now say, aging brings a suffering and sickness brings a suffering. Death definitely brings us suffering. And also, the things we like, when we don't get those things, the suffering comes to us. And we like something, when we don't get that, the suffering comes. And also there are some things that we don't like to have. When it comes to our lives, the suffering comes. And also there are some people that we like to associate, to be with. But when we have to depart from all those people, suffering comes. And also there are some people that we don't like to associate. When they come to our lives, we are having suffering. So Lord Buddha said, this is the suffering. In short, Lord Buddha said, Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, Sanskar, Vinyana is all about suffering.
So that's the five aggregates.
Five aggregates. So, Lord Buddha said, if somebody wants to have the freedom from all these sufferings, he needs to have the faith. Because if somebody doesn't have a faith in Lord Buddha, then he won't believe the words of the Lord Buddha, the teachings of the Lord Buddha. And also he won't believe there were disciples, there are disciples and there will be disciples in the world who got that supreme liberation following the teachings of the Lord Buddha. Therefore Lord Buddha said, the base, the main thing is confidence. Confidence in Lord Buddha. Confidence in the teachings of the Lord Buddha. Confidence in the disciples, we say monks, in Lord Buddha. So to have the faith, we should know the qualities of those things. We should know the qualities of Lord Buddha. We should know the qualities about the teachings of the Buddha, and we should know the qualities of the Mahasangha. And when we talk about this faith or the confidence, there are two. There is a faith, it is called Amulika Saddha. That means it is a rootless faith.
A blind faith.
Blind faith. There is no root.
There is no root.
It can be uprooted very easily by someone else, by doing something, by showing something else. It is like this. Now say, if we don't know who the Buddha is throughout the qualities of the Lord Buddha, then if somebody says, no, there is someone else greater than this, then we, or that person might tend to think about that also, then he will lose this path. So that blind faith brings him to a bad place, right?
Because he loses confidence, and therefore that he will not have that.
So then what we have to do is, we have to have the confidence. So that blind faith is not the faith that a Buddhist should have, or the person who likes to have the supreme liberation should have.
This is faith through conviction.
Yeah.
You have to be convinced of the fact that there is something about it, virtuosity of the Buddha, or the Buddha's qualities, as well as I said.
Yes.
Those things have to be there, but through conviction.
Yes. Then only you can, or somebody can develop the faith. So that amulika santa, that means this blind faith, is not bringing us something great. Why is that? When somebody says there is something else than this, then he might change the path. Then he will lose the path. Then he will lose the supreme liberation. So when he is having a blind faith, without having a good understanding about the qualities of the Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, then he will lose the things. Now say in Buddha's time, there was a monk called Devadatta. The monk who tried to kill Lord Buddha. He tried 3 times. So he gathered, there were some other monks also. Those monks
supported him.
But all those monks got the monkhood under the Lord Buddha.
But there was a conviction of faith on Buddha. That's why they
no,
shifted
they
their faith too.
They don't have a real faith. They had a what? Blind faith.
So they shifted
their faith. That is why they said goodbye to the Buddha and went with
Devadatta.
But one day Lord Buddha said, some monks of mine have gone with Devadatta. They are going to be in a danger. So Sariputta, along with Moggallana, you may go there. Lord Buddha asked the great 2 disciples of the Buddha to go there and take them back. So what they did was, those 2 went. Then that Devadatta thought, oh, those 2 disciples are also coming to me. Now my target is easy. I can be the Buddha next. So he said, as Buddha, okay, now come and sit down both sides of mine. And today I'm so tired. So you may preach Dhamma to these monks. Then Devadatta went to the room and started sleeping. At that time, Sariputta Bhante, Venerable Sariputta and Mahamoggallana teach the Dhamma to those monks and made the great faith, which is having a root, that is called Akaravati Saddha.
Understand and the conviction.
The
that comes
faith with a good understanding. Then they became the follower of the Buddha and went to the Buddha with those 2 great disciples. So why is that? Why did it happen? It happened, those monks before had a blind faith. After having a good understanding about the Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, because of the discourses of Sariputta, Arahant Sariputta.
Arahant Sariputta and Moggallana.
They got the faith where there is a root. That means they made an unshakable faith in them. They became Sotapan and went. So, if somebody is having blind faith, it brings a danger to him. Because anybody can cheat him. But Lord Buddha said, if somebody is having an Akaravati Saddha, that means where there is a root, nobody can uproot it. Lord Buddha said it is like this. In Ratana Sutta, that means the discourse on jewels, Lord Buddha said, Yatinda kilo pataving sitosya chatubbi vatebi asampakampya. In the cities, when there is a, you know, road where there are four ways, in the middle the people are digging, people dug a hole and, you know, up to 15, 14 feet and put a height fee, you know, pillar. Long pillar.
Erected on that hole.
Yeah. And then they established it well. After establishing, if a wind comes from the south, it won't shake to the north.
North.
And if the wind comes from the north, it won't shake
towards the south.
Towards the south. Likewise, that faith doesn't change. That is called Akaravati Saddha. But blind faith is like this. Lord Buddha said it is just like a leaf of a banana tree which is dried up. When the wind comes from the south, what happens?
It moves to the north.
It moves to the north. And when the wind comes from the north, that goes to the
south.
And when the wind comes from the east, it goes to the west. When the wind comes from the west, it goes to the
east.
So, blind faith is like this. It is like this. When somebody comes and says, no, this is not the correct thing, you come to ours and we will teach you the best way, then there may be a truth. And he goes to that side.
There is a doubt.
But if somebody is having a good faith, which is established in him, then nobody can change him.
That's vichikicca in
Yeah, because Pali, if somebody is not knowing about doubt. The qualities of the Buddha, he is having a doubt. But if somebody knows that, nobody can change him. I will tell you a nice story. In the Buddha's time, Lord Buddha's time, there was a man who was having a skin disease. It's a kind of a rash, we say leper, right? And he was just begging on the road. One day he went on the road and he saw a huge gathering was there. And he just thought then, okay, there may be somebody giving food for these people. So I also should go there and get some food. His name was Suppabuddha. Then, what happened when he went through the people he saw, Lord Buddha was preaching Dhamma. Then he thought, okay, then useless going back. I came for food, but I would listen what the Lord Buddha is teaching. Then he listened to the Dhamma, and fortunately, what happened? He understood that Dhamma and became an stream entrant. In Pali we say Sotapan. That means he made an unshakable faith in Lord Buddha, unshakable faith in the teachings of the Lord Buddha, an unshakable faith in the order of monks, and he made his precepts unbreakable. So he became Sotapanna. How he became Sotapanna? Stream entrant? By establishing confidence, perfect confidence in those qualities of triple chan.
Is it the previous practice, or is it what we call parami, or over a period of time knowing the Dhamma, and for him to get into that exalted
position? Actually, he had a merit
that would have given him the push in the previous lives. No?
Right? Lord Buddha said, only the wise understand this Dhamma.
That's why I left out Prajna,
One day somebody came to the Lord Buddha and asked, Lord Buddha, if you tell the teachings like this, then everybody will be having the supreme liberation. Then who there is to control this world? Then Lord Buddha said, it never happens. Only the wise understand this Dhamma. That is why everybody is not having the supreme liberation. See, in this world there are 800 crores, but how many Buddhists? And among the Buddhists also, how many of them are following the real thing? Right? So, that is why Lord Buddha said, only the wise understands this Dhamma. Then something nice happened. Now that Super Buddha, that leper, said, paid homage to the Lord Buddha and went back. At that time, somebody who is great in the divine world, the leader of two heavenly worlds, saw this man and thought like this. Now this man became a supreme disciple, became a disciple of Lord Buddha. Now if somebody blames this man, he will be having lot of demerits. It will bring him so many suffering in the hell. So I should do something for this, and came to the human world soon and appeared in front of Super Buddha and said to Super Buddha, I will give you any amount of wealth. I will make you a very rich man. I will give you a palace. I will give you servants. But you have to do one thing. Now the god Indra, we call Sakka, is trying to check his faith, because he wanted to help him. Then,
and he was trying to entice him by saying that he is going to afford him all these things.
He is going to check. Yes. Right? Yeah. And then God Sakka said, but you have to do something. With one condition, he said, you go back to the people and said, Buddha is not true. What Lord Buddha taught is not true. All the disciples are not true. As you learned, the I is not impermanent. Go and say. Lord Buddha said that I is impermanent, but you go and say, the I is not impermanent. There is something impermanent. Likewise, the Sakka tried to instruct the leper. Then he looked at the god and he said, who you are to say me like that? Do you know who I am? Do you dare to say me like that? You know I am a disciple of Lord Buddha. am a disciple of that great sage. So aren't you afraid to talk with me like that? And are you a fool to say like this? If you also like to have something good, you also go and see Buddha, then you will have something great. And what happened? That leper said, I don't need your wealth. That wealth is impermanent. Your palace, your gold, all the things will be impermanent. But what I had is permanent. What? He had the way which leads him to the supreme liberation. Now he is on the direct path. Within 7 births, definitely he will achieve the supreme liberation. So he said like that and went back to the Lord Buddha and said, Lord Buddha, something happened like this to me on my way back. Somebody appeared in front of me and said like that, but I said, I am a disciple of yours and I know that I have an unshakable faith. So what happened? Among the people, everybody knew that he is having an unshakable faith. He has become a sotapan. What happened? He went back on the way. A cow came and knocked him and killed him at that place. Then somebody might think he has seen the Buddha, developed the faith in him. But see, the tragedy happened to him. But it is not a tragedy at all. What happened? He went to the heaven after the death. And he is having only another 7 births. And he will be having definitely the supreme liberation. So see, that akaravati saddha, the confidence where there is a root, brings him the supreme liberation. If somebody is not having, he might be cheated. Now if that leper or super Buddha did not have the faith which is unshakable, then he would say, okay, then give me that palace, give me the gold and I will tell. But he had an unshakable faith. That is why he couldn't be cheated even by the gods. But today, in this world, we are cheated very simply. Why is that? Sometimes some people say in the society, for a lunch packet they can be cheated. Right? But the people who are having unshakable faith, those who know the qualities of the Buddha, those who know the qualities of the teachings of the Buddha, those who know the qualities of those Mahasangha, they can't be cheated because they know the truth. So that is why Lord Buddha said, the base, the foundation should be the confidence or the faith. But if somebody is having a blind faith, he won't be having something great. That is why I said to you, we should have the faith first. He didn't know much. He didn't talk about a lot of great Dhamma practice. But he had this unshakable faith for the things what we should have the faith, then it led him to the supreme liberation. Even today, we should have that. Right?
So now you are talking about faith. Now together with that, you get the strengths, and into the strengths, okay, the wisdom and mindfulness we left out for the time being, and we were concentrating on as to how to have faith, and then comes effort. Now, when you talk about effort, what type of effort do you require? Because what happens is now, without effort, you cannot have this unshakable faith, because you develop, inculcate something within yourself, that effort has to be something which has to be continuous, at least, yes, till it develops or blooms into some sort of unshakable faith. And to do that, you need this, to inaugurate yourself by having this effort within you. So how do you describe this effort? How should one develop effort in oneself?
Actually, even to have Shraddha, to have faith in others, that effort should be there, right? So without having Shraddha, faith, we can't have the next stage.
Yeah, because even here Suprabuddha went into the crowd, because
yes,
he made some effort on his part to find out who this is, why this congregation are there, why have the people assembled, for what purpose. So there was some sort of effort on his part as well.
Yes.
When he went on to meet Lord Buddha, and suddenly he saw Lord Buddha being there and giving a discourse, on and so forth. So that's why this effort, that's why I thought I should ask you about this effort.
Yeah,
how one should do it.
Talking about the Buddha's teaching, effort is something else. We make some efforts to make houses, we make some efforts to make something else. But Buddha taught about right effort.
Yes.
Right?
The right comes with him.
Yeah, right effort.
Right effort.
Right effort means the person is trying to root out the unwholesome things that arise to him. Now say
wholesome and unwholesome.
Wholesome and unwholesome things.
That's kusala kusala.
Kusala kusala.
Kusala kusala.
Then there is in a person, now unwholesome deeds have been arised. Now he is trying to root out all those things.
So you try to suppress those.
Yeah. Now say
there are several
somebody is killing animals. Somebody is stealing. Somebody is having missexual conduct. Don't you think we need much effort to overcome from that? So effort comes like that.
Because you have to grapple with it, and there are two versions. One says suppression, but some says you need effort to suppress those thoughts when
yes,
it comes. Later on it will develop, there won't be the requirement of suppression there. Then automatically you will realize to yourself these wholesome thoughts, unwholesome thoughts. You will be able to keep aside those thoughts. But
yes,
initially you need that.
Yes. So, according to Lord Buddha, effort should be to develop wholesome things and root out unwholesome things in a person. So we can describe, we can discuss about that big topic in the Noble Eightfold Path.
But for the time being, the effort and the faith, how do you see that, Sarvanasan? Now, without going into right effort,
yeah,
is it effort required in order to sustain this faith in yourself? Or
yes, of course. Now see, if somebody wants to follow this, the teachings of the Lord Buddha, he has to make a lot of efforts. Simply we say, now in the normal society, when the people are associated, sometimes they try to tell lies. Sometimes they happen to kill animals. Some people say that without telling lies, we can't live in this society. But to stop telling lies, he had to make a lot of efforts. To stop killing, even to coming to the noble disciples, noble friends, he has to have a great effort. Or else, what happens? He will lose the path on the way.
This is what you call Satpurusha Sevanaya, that
yeah,
comes in
association
there
of noble friends.
Noble friends.
But the worldly people are not fond of that side. They like to go on the path. They like to go in the samsaric journey. Most of the people are not trying to get rid of this trouble. So they try to take the people into their side. To come out of that, then we need effort, right? So then that effort plays a major role. Now see, I'll tell you some example for that. There were two young boys in Lord Buddha's time named Upatissa and Kolita. They were having a very luxurious life, very rich. What happened was they felt there should be something beyond this. We have everything. We have wealth, we have wives, we have anything, everything. But the life is not perfect. There is something missing.
Unsatisfied.
Unsatisfied. Because every day they are going to see cinemas, dramas and all those things and trying to be happy, but that happiness doesn't come. So they two gathered and discussed, there should be something great. There should be something which brings us a supreme happiness, supreme liberation. Better find that. So what happened? They discussed to say goodbye to the homely life. Don't you think that for that, do we need some effort? We need, right?
We need.
We need effort. So they said goodbye to those things. Normally people are thinking having a house, having a family, having a vehicle. In the present world, they think that happiness comes through that way. But they said goodbye to those things and thought to find the real happiness out of something else.
What you're saying, Charan, is you started out by saying this about suffering.
Yeah.
Now this is suffering. Basically what you say is you are unsatisfied with anything, whatever you have.
Every being in the world.
Which pleases your faculties like ear, nose, tongue, you know, body, mind. But you are unsatisfied whatever you have because there is impermanence in whatever you have. You can't cling on to it.
Yes.
So therefore it appears and disappears.
Yeah, you have no control over these things.
You have no, so there is no atma, there is no controlling factor also in a way. So this unsatisfied, because a lot of people misunderstand the fact that suffering means, Buddhism is very negative, very pessimistic type of dhamma, because always you keep talking about suffering. But actually what suffering means is that you are unsatisfied with whatever you have, that craving, clinging pushes you into achieve more and more and more. But besides that, because it's impermanent, you end up in suffering.
Yes, because all about the world means everything is suffering. Now imagine, we learn with an idea to bring happiness. What happened? That learning itself brings him suffering when he is failing the exam. Right? We are having a family life with an idea to get happiness. What happens? The children and the wives, when they become sick, when they die, is happiness coming to us or is the sadness comes? Sadness comes. We are trying to get happiness out of something impermanent. That impermanent thing never brings us happiness. So Lord Buddha first said, there is a suffering. It is the noble truth, the first noble truth. Nobody can't say there is a suffering. There is no a. Nobody can say there is no suffering. There is a suffering in the world. Though a Lord Buddha appears or not in a world, the suffering is there. All are suffering, though they don't like to talk about suffering, though they say this is negative or positive. The suffering is in the world. It is a noble truth.
And then there is emergence of suffering within you when the faculties come across with pass, with contact.
Yes.
You develop this certain, moods of happiness.
Yes.
Then again it ends up in, because of impermanence, ends up in some sort of distraught or in some unhappiness or something like that which brings upon you.
That is why Lord Buddha said like this, Saddhati Tathagata Sabodhin. One should develop confidence in the understanding of Lord Buddha. What Lord Buddha understood under the Bodhi tree in Gaya before 2600 years back? Lord Buddha understood aging, death, sickness,
decay,
and all those things brings suffering to our lives. And Lord Buddha told that is the first noble truth. Lord Buddha didn't stop there. He went further. He found the cause of suffering. Now people who are telling Lord Buddha is negative, Lord Buddha is talking something negative, don't know these factors, that is why. But Lord Buddha discussed, Lord Buddha found the cause of suffering. Lord Buddha said, the cause of suffering is desire within you. Nobody made this suffering, Lord Buddha said. No your father, no your mother, no Brahmin, no God, no Mara made this thing. But you yourself, throughout your desire, made those suffering. Understand? You have a desire to marriage, have a marriage. You have a desire to make children. You had a desire to have a job. Those desires brought you suffering, not your father, not your mother. So the cause of suffering is what? Desire. That is the second noble truth. Lord Buddha didn't stop there also. See how amazing Lord Buddha is. See how compassionate Lord Buddha is. Those who don't know about these things are telling something wrong about Lord Buddha. And Lord Buddha said, there is a cessation of suffering also. There is a cessation of suffering. How can somebody cessate the suffering?
Or rather, the way out of it, no? The liberation.
Yeah. How can...
That's the Noble Eightfold Path.
Yeah. No, somebody can root out the suffering, end this suffering by rooting out the desire in him. When there is no desire, then there is no suffering. So if somebody wants to have the happiness, he should know there is a suffering. And he should know the way that suffering arises. The origination of suffering he should know. And he should know there is a cessation also. And then Lord Buddha didn't stop there also. He went further on. Why is that? He knew all the things. Lord Buddha is the knower of the world. Lord Buddha is the seer of the world. We don't know the things. Understand? But the people who think like they know get into trouble because they don't know at all. But they think that they know the things. So Lord Buddha said, by following a path, by following a system, you can have the cessation of suffering. You can go out of this suffering. What is the path? That is the Noble Eightfold Path. Lord Buddha said, out of this path, nobody can have the liberation.
So
nobody
that,
can have the cessation.
Cessation. Sir, you are talking about the emergence of dukkha, the suffering,
yep.
The emergence, and then the cessation.
Yeah.
And with all that, now we know it's a noble about the Noble Eightfold Path.
Yeah.
Now there you get samadhitti.
Yes.
And sammasankappa.
Yeah.
Now this right understanding also plays a role here.
Yeah.
So how does now, as you were saying, that this is the only way out, the cessation, the way out of it.
Yeah.
It's a Noble Eightfold Path. Then we talk about the Four Noble Truths, as dukkha, what dukkha is, how it comes about, and the cessation of dukkha. So, sammaditti, how can you describe the right understanding? Because right, that also helps faith.
Yeah. Actually, right understanding is, he understands there is a suffering. He understands there is a cause of suffering. He understands there is a cessation of suffering. He understands there is a path leading to the cessation of suffering. So here, Lord Buddha said, if somebody believes, if somebody makes a faith confidence on Lord Buddha's teaching, the understanding, he will come to this cessation. Understand? Hmm. So, what happened was, now I talk about that Upatis and Kalita. They went in seeking the real happiness. And on the way, Sariputta Bhante told, it is useless going in the same way. So we'll
split and go
in two ways. Once you meet the supreme way, then come to me. Or else once I meet, I'll come to you. And when Upatissa went on the road, he found a charming ascetic, very nice ascetic. His head was bald and he was wearing a yellow robe. And his way is very nice. And he went to that monk and asked, who is your teacher? What he is teaching? That day, out of those five monks, the first five monks of Lord Buddha, the fifth one, Assaji Thero, the Arahant, Assaji Thero was going there on that road. Then, when Upatissa is asking who is your teacher and what he is teaching, Assaji Thero told, dear friend, my teacher is Lord Buddha. And I am a new disciple of Lord Buddha. I don't know much, but I know something. Then Upatissa told, okay, tell me in brief, I can understand in length. So what happened was, Assaji Thero told like this, Ye dhamma hetu pabhava, te sang hetu tatagato vaha, te sanchayo nirodo, evang vadi mahasamano. When Assaji Thero is telling that stanza, there were four lines. There are four lines in that stanza. When he was telling the second line, that Upatissa became a stream entrant, became a sotapanna one. Why is that? Because he accepted, he believes the understanding of the Lord Buddha with confidence, faith. He knew that, yes, this is the answer for my question. This is the way to have the supreme liberation. This is the way to have the supreme happiness. What it said, Ye dhamma hetu pabhava, te sang hetu tatagato vaha. Because of something, because of a cause, the effect comes. That means Lord Buddha said there is an
cause and effect
theory. Once he is hearing that, he understood that. What he understood? The understanding of the Lord Buddha. What he did? He questioned. Did he question? No. He himself
understood
and made an unshakable faith without even seeing the Lord Buddha. How he saw the Lord Buddha? Through his Dhamma. That is why Lord Buddha said, Yo Dhammang Passati, so Mang Passati. So yo mang pasate. So dhammang pasate. If somebody sees Dhamma, he sees me. If somebody sees me, he sees Dhamma. Then how upatissa saw Lord Buddha? Through the teachings of the Lord Buddha. Without seeing the Lord Buddha, upatissa became a stream entrant. But we have seen many times the statues. We heard a lot about the Lord Buddha's teachings. But still we are in the journey which is endless. What is the reason? Throughout this journey, we couldn't make an unshakable faith in the teachings of the Lord Buddha. That is why I said you.
There's no proper understanding.
There is no proper understanding. That is what the reason. So that is why I said you, the faith makes a lot. Faith plays a major role in this path where we can find the supreme liberation.
Because I said, beyond that, of course, when you think about the right to understand, together with comes avyapada, avihinsa, sankappa, and kamma sankappa.
Yes.
Total renunciation. I don't think we have the time to go into all those areas right now. But
yeah.
If you give some thought to renunciation, now as a bhikkhu you have renounced so many things. From now we talk about 5 precepts, then it goes into 8, then it goes to Patimokkha Sanghara Sila, which goes up to 207.
Yeah.
So now this renunciation. How should one start about renouncing this? Okay. Now of course we are in the worldly life.
Yeah.
Lokottara and Laukika. You get, but in general, day-to-day life, this renunciation, from where do you start? Is there a way of renouncing? Because craving and clinging, we have to start somewhere. In short, I know it will be very sort of brief answer that I'm expecting from you because of time. Will you be able to enlighten us on that, Swayanand sir?
Then also, we have to go to the faith. Now, talking about Lord Buddha's disciples, they had the faith in Lord Buddha. They had the faith in Dhamma and Sangha. With that faith, they thought that there is an answer for the suffering. There is an answer for the endless journey. So with the faith, they renounced. How many? Millions. From the Buddha's time up to this. From Anya Kondanyatero to today's disciple and to the future disciples. How they renounce? Because they know by hearing the teachings of the Lord Buddha, yes, this is the truth. The truth of suffering is the greatest truth in the world. When the Lord Buddha is discussing this among the people, those who are wise enough to understand decides useless going in this endless journey.
So what you're saying, Swayanand, is cause and effect is there, that leads to unsatisfactoriness or to sorrow or suffering.
Yes.
You reverse the process by cutting off craving, clinging, everything. That is through renunciation of so many things, factors. And that could be done because of faith.
Yes.
Right understanding, proper understanding, faith in Dhamma will lead you to that.
Yes, of course.
To reverse the process.
Yes, of course. Because without having the faith, you can't make the Lord Buddha your leader. Without having the faith, you can't make the Lord Buddha's teachings the instructions of your path. Without having the faith in Mahasangha, those who attained the supreme liberation following the path, you won't make even one step forward. But if you hear these things, the stories and all those things, the teachings of the Buddha, then the people tend to think, and by trying to understanding those great teachings throughout their wisdom, they decide. That is why all those who are not hearing the Dhamma are not renouncing, are not becoming Buddhists. Now see, there are some other religious priests. They are sometimes well in Tripitaka. They know all the suttas of Lord Buddha. They know all the factors of Dhamma. Sometimes they come to us and discuss. But they didn't even come to Buddhism. They didn't come to even to this path. Why is that? They are not wise enough to understand this.
They have a doubt in their mind. They are not convinced.
They are not
convinced because they have not understood.
Actually, the thing is, they are not wise enough. That is why. They don't know this reality. They don't have a faith in this. They are seeking the faith throughout something. But Lord Buddha said, if somebody is trying to have the happiness out of Noble Eightfold Path, it won't happen. If somebody wants to have the supreme liberation, that person should follow the Noble Eightfold Path, or else there won't be a supreme liberation. That means if somebody wants to have the supreme liberation, they should have to follow the path of Lord Buddha, which is taught by the Lord Buddha. And then he should be the disciple of Lord Buddha. They should follow the teachings of the Lord Buddha. They should follow the disciples of Lord Buddha. To follow that, to come to that, what they should have? Again, I would say, they should have the faith. That is the starting point. See, now when we talk about that saddha, Lord Buddha said, saddha mattang pema mattang. In a discourse, Lord Buddha said, if somebody is having a little faith, a small faith, small love in Lord Buddha, he would have a birth in the heaven, a place where there is a little happiness. There is a happiness. And we call sugati. So what happened is, one day Lord Buddha was going on the road, arms round. And Lord Buddha saw a very old woman, around 90 years old. She couldn't walk properly, using a walking stick. She was walking, and Lord Buddha saw through his divine eye that this lady is not having a long life now. Today itself, she is going to die. Lord Buddha knew that if she dies like this, she will be born in the hell. Lord Buddha, out of compassion, went to that lady and said, dear mother, look at me. I am the Lord Buddha, the greatest sage, the enlightened one. And take refuge in me. Believe in me. Have confidence in me. It will bring you so much happiness. What she did was she looked up. She saw the greatest face ever seen in the world. She made a faith by looking at Lord Buddha. What happened was, Lord Buddha went arms round. After passing that place, that lady was looking at the Lord Buddha until they are passing. After that, a cow came and knocked herself and died. Once Lord Buddha was there in the temple, she came illuminating the whole temple. And what happened? She said, Lord Buddha, can't you recognize me? I am the old lady who met you on the way today morning. After having faith in you, a cow came and killed me. But because of having a little faith, I went to the divine realm. And I am having a very luxurious thing. My whole palace is made out of gold. Everywhere I have divine servants. Everywhere I am having anything. So see, by looking at you, Lord Buddha, I had this much. So I don't know if I follow the path of yours, how much I can gain.
Because that too is impermanent, and therefore that also has to.
But
you by can going, develop yourself, advance yeah. yourself.
And by going to such a world, there is a very good possibility. There is a very good chance by associating noble friends who are in the divine realms, who became stream entrants, who became once returners, who became non-returners there, they can associate them and get the path. That is why we say it is better to go to such a place if somebody is not in a position to become an arahant this time itself. So that is how the faith develops. Faith brings happiness. And also I would like to say something which is relevant to this time also. You know, in the kingdom called Magadha, the city in Rajagaha, right? The king was Bimbisara. His son was Ajasatta. And what happened was Ajasatta
tortured the father.
Yeah, wanted to get the crown and put the father into the jail. And mother was going to the jail taking the food. But he wanted to kill father by putting into the jail, but the father is not dying. Then he saw how, why is that? Then he thought that he saw that my mother is taking food. That is why he is alive. Then she stopped taking food. Then what mother did? She applied the food by making into, you know, small pieces, you know, making into a porridge, and applied all the food on her and covered with a cloth and went to the king and gave the food. Still the king is alive. Then King Ajasatta found, because of my mother is taking food like that, my father is alive, so then stopped that also. You see your husband being far. And then what happened was, still he is having the life. And then what Ajasatta did was, he cut his leg, you know, the
split the thing and
yeah, the
put
feet
salt into it,
into huh? pieces, and put salt and asked him to walk on the fire. By that time, Bimbisara is a stream entrant, right? But if something happens to us today, what happened? I went refuge, I took refuge in Lord Buddha, I took refuge in Dhamma, I took refuge in Sangha. So that doesn't come to protect me. We say like that, right? But Bimbisara didn't say like that. Why is that? He is having unshakable faith. And he knows all these things are impermanent. And he knows that within 7 births, he will
succeed.
He knows that already he is in the path. And he knows how to face the world, how to face the happiness, how to face the sadness, how to face the, how to face everything he knows. That is why Bimbisara did like that. Then Bimbisara died and had a birth in the heaven as Janavasabha. Came to Lord Buddha, said, Lord Buddha, if somebody have faith in Lord Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, and also follow having the protecting the precepts, he will be having something great that is the supreme liberation. He will end this endless journey. And Lord Buddha, I'm waiting to be a once returner. But he didn't complain about the son. See, Lord Buddha, I gave him the kingdom and he cut my leg, he put salt into that and he asked me to, you know, walk on the fire and see, he killed me. He didn't tell all these things. What he told was, Lord Buddha, I'm waiting to be a
once returner.
See the minds of the disciples of the Lord Buddha, because they know the reality. So everything comes because of what? Everything came because of the faith. When Bimbisara saw the ascetic Gautama, when before becoming the Lord Buddha, he said, please come to my city first after having the enlightenment. And to fulfill that, Lord Buddha went to the same city to respect the king Bimbisara. And after seeing the Lord Buddha, Bimbisara became a disciple of Lord Buddha and attained that stream entrance. So everything brought those happiness. Now Bimbisara didn't cry. Why is that? Because he knew the reality. Lord Bimbisara didn't ask, oh, when Lord Buddha is coming to rescue me? Is he coming to rescue me? Bimbisara didn't want such a rescue because he is already rescued by the Lord Buddha, giving the teachings of the Buddha.
Thank you, Sanaza. I think time has come, and I think we should, in our second program, not next week, yeah, after, because Jnanaji Sanaza will be on our program next week, and we can continue from here, from faith, from where we end today's program, and we can take it up again, I think, on the next date, which is connected to faith, whatever is connected to faith, to go on the progression from faith to, you know, the other factors that are brought upon, where one should have some understanding in order to be on the path, at least not on the path, at least to make some effort to get onto the path even. So, Sanasa, with much gratitude, Sanasa, I will seek your permission to close the program. So, today's program, in fact, was where we actually were having the Sinhala program and then we switched over to English for the benefit. There was a request in fact made, which I forgot at the outset, at the introduction, to inform our viewers, because the request was for us to have a Dhamma program in Sinhala as well. It is not for only for the purpose for the other communities and for the foreign layman, because some of these things get onto our website from there on, that there is a requirement right now, a demand for the Dhamma. And besides that, in fact, we also got a lot of requests for us to do a program in English. And that's what brought upon the thought, the seed was given birth to by this particular program. And in fact, previously we had the Dhamma programs with the former Chief Justice, Justice Sarathsen Silva, who actually was a trendsetter and a forerunner for the Dhamma programs in English, and which we did. And then we started on the Dhamma programs in Sinhala, where it was a requirement. And then this request was brought upon to Lokaswami Nase, asking us to have some programs in English and then to propagate the Dhamma through English, so that for the better consumption of the Dhamma by our viewers. And today was basically, we went to the basics of the Dhamma. From there on, we will try the progression and how it should be developed. And so we confined ourselves to faith, why faith is required and what type of faith is this. Is it blind faith or faith brought upon with understanding and conviction? And I think this was very simplified and illustrated in a very simple format by Asaji, Venerable Asaji. And so we will take forward, we will carry forward this, the message of the Dhamma, or what we call it, the propagation and understanding of the Dhamma, into make society also better society than whatever is there. Right now we know there are so many issues and blemishes in the society. So I thank you, Venerable Lassaji. And so we will be completing this program, and we hope to see you in the next week's Namo Buddhaya program, which will be at 9:30. And till then, Upasamata Turan Sarnai Namo Buddhaya.
Namo Buddhaya. Namo Buddhaya. Namo Buddhaya. Namo Buddhaya. Namo Buddhaya. Namo Buddhaya.